Hagai, this is, you know, you got status, you have this Gutman chair, you're all this kind of thing, but you've been getting bad publicity on the YouTube about drilling holes in monkey skulls. How do you deal with that kind of thing?
It is correct that I'm getting bad publicity, and it is even more correct that a person has to do what he has to do. And from my point of view, being a medical doctor, think patient, I am very, very aware of the suffer that we see in the world. And I am very, very aware that our current knowledge and our treatment are not completed. We have to improve them. I do see patient with Parkinson's disease, patient with depression, patient with schizophrenia every day. And the suffering of this patient is something that I think that we as community, as a society, have to do our best in order to help them. And then one has to make a decision. Either I do experiment on animal, taking into account all the ethical rule, the 3 R, which are reduce the species, reduce the number, and reduce the suffer, but do experiment on animal and improve our knowledge, or the other choice is to do experiment on human. This is the only choice, because we cannot stop here. There is no way that we learn just from the air, that someone will give us the knowledge. We don't have the knowledge, and we have to do experiment in order to find the better treatment of the future.
But you can do that here. You can do research on monkeys still.
We can do, again, we are under the supervision of ethical committee, of the local vet and the national committee, but still, I think that people in this country are, and we have our animal rights protester as well as in the United States, Canada, and Europe, but I think that people here are, or at least I and my students and other people understand the ethical conflict. And the ethical conflict is never black and white. Because if it was black and white, there is no need for ethical decision.
Right,
okay?
Right.
Ethic is coming only when you are having this gray level decision. And the gray level decision are, okay, we stay here, we have our knowledge, and we are trying to fake some knowledge from the air, or from air, I mean, computer simulation, and so on, or we do experiment. And then experiment can be done either on human, and this actually, this is not my ethic. My ethic say, if you have a good idea that you believe in it, try it first on animal. Use the ethical rule of, the ethical rule that said, reduce species, okay? If you are able to do it on the dish, do it on the dish. But if you are unable, go to rodent. If you are unable to do it on rodent, do it on monkey. But do it and prove to yourself that you have the correct way in order to help people.
But it's now a whole atmosphere in, it's still allowed. You can do monkey research supposedly in Canada and the States, but it's very hard to do it because the political pressure, the correct decision, the bureaucracy you have to go through to get all the permissions, people say, I'll do something else.
So again, it's coming back to the fact that actually one has to make his own decision. You can surrender to the pressure and then do the less optimized way, or you can fight with it. And I think that we as Israeli are used to fight, so we keep this kind of fight, and we are still able, again, we are living in very, very similar environment, but still you can see that we are able to do this kind of experiment on monkey. And from my point of view, this, for example, one experiment that I was doing in 87 to 1990 was the experiment that tell us that the best target for surgery for Parkinson's disease is the subthalamic nucleus. This is the target that we identify in 1990, and this is the target that is now used all over the world for more than 50,000 patients all over the world, Canada, United States, Europe, and also in Israel, we have our national program, and here in Hadassah, we have done more than 200 patients with implantation of deep brain stimulation electrode to the subthalamic nucleus, to the same target that we have identified in monkey experiment. So the question is coming back to the issue. Would you prefer that experiment will be done on human being, And this will not be done in Canada. It will be probably done in some more less lucky place of the world, okay? But it will be done on human, or you have the decision and making on animal. And this is my personal decision that it is more ethical to do it this
way. Well, I want to get into that decision making, because it's ironic, because your research is also about decision making and the process of decision making. And I read one of your papers, which I found fascinating, that the old tradition that you're risk averse. And my experience with Israel when I was a Lady Davis visiting professor here is Israelis are risk prone compared to Canadians. Canadians are risk averse. But there's a general theory we're all risk averse, and only relatively so. But you did work to show that there's a problem in the chemistry of the body that makes us prone to be to take risks. Explain that to me.
So again, we are coming back to this point of dopamine. This neurotransmitter, okay? This neurochemical that we create in the brain, and that actually make the balance, because all our balance, we have to find the optimal trade-off between taking risk versus doing the same old policy that we are used to do, okay? Or exploration versus exploitation. Clearly, if you know something, the best thing is not to take the risk and to do whatever you do. But then you never know if over there is something much better. If you will not explore, if you will not take the risk, then you will, maybe you will do okay, but you will not find something which is better. And dopamine, this neurotransmitter that we are missing in the Parkinsonian patient, is the one that is actually creating or putting the balance between the how much we'd like to explore or to take the risk, or how much we'd like to exploit. And for each of one of us, it is a matter of, I would say, biological, social, drive that put this correct balance. Maybe we are an Israeli, maybe we are as a Jewish actually, we are never happy with the current situation, okay? So we should look for something better, okay? And this is why maybe we have more dopamine, we move more.
Has there been any experiments to see if a particular ethnic group has more dopamine than another? Well, I don't know of any.
There are some experiments, not in my field, regarding the genetic predisposition, so different kind of receptors and so on. This is not my field, but from my point of view, I can look at the person, the way person is behaving, and say, this is a guy with big amount of dopamine, and he's now dropping down.
Because Israel is a very risk prone society, certainly relative to Canadians. And it may be that there is a different chemical structure. Would be interesting to find out. It's pretty speculative, though. It's probably more cultural than anything else.
But culture changes chemical in the brain. This is the point. My point is that, yes, I think that culture, behavior, society influence our brain.
So it has a feedback effect.
And therefore, again, it is not only genetics that influence our brain. It is what we study, the way that we interact, and the way that we are influenced by the society that change our brain. So this might be...
Well, because, Israel is known as a very innovative society. It has to take risks to survive as a society, but it's also very innovative in all fields. It's not just medicine and physiology, etc. I want to go into, and we're going to run out of time, and so I'm going to ask you to bear with me. Would you mind doing another section of an interview? I know we promised you only two, but I haven't done your brain surgery. I've done other questions I want to ask you. Do you mind?
If you're okay.
It's okay? Okay. So let's take a break, and then we're going to come back and we'll do another segment. Okay? Thanks a lot.